Welcome back from the break. Now, with all the recent debates on coffee, who should export and who shouldn't, this week we look at how working within an association could actually boost production for the country.
Let's start with how New Cafe works with farmers and what your goal is.
Very good. First of all, my name is Joseph Nkando. I'm the executive director of New Cafe. New Cafe is the National Association of Coffee Farmers. It is a membership organization owned and run by farmers themselves. As a membership organization, to date, we have over 1.5 million smallholder coffee farmers that are part of New Cafe, and they are organized within the communities where they produce coffee in over 200 associations and cooperatives. New Cafe runs on the farmer ownership model. What this means is that farmers take ownership by taking responsibility as masters of their own destiny. It means that farmers don't wait for somebody to come and say, "Oh, I'm giving you this." Not at all. You know, from within the farmers, we say we need to be self-sustaining. And this is a pain that we have to go through for the current but also future generations. The problem we are working on is that for a long time, coffee farmers have been earning less than 5% of their retail value. And this is the most important thing that we are working on as New Cafe, to ensure that we break the intergenerational poverty that has been characterized with the farmers from generation to generation. And not any other model that can do that. It is the farmer ownership model. But we know how hard it is for us to ensure that the farmer ownership model becomes the normal business model for not only the coffee value chain, but also other agricultural value chain. So what happens with the farmer ownership model? As farmers produce their coffee, New Cafe is at their disposal to empower them, to train them, to pass on the necessary skills for them to produce the quality of coffee that is needed by the consumer. So the farmer must be able to speak the language that the consumer understands. And therefore, New Cafe is there to ensure that it passes on what kind of attributes that the consumer is looking for in the coffee. So the handling practices, the good agricultural practices, the climate smart solutions that are needed at the farm level are key for New Cafe to carry on with all its members. Now, after the farmers produce the coffee has to be brought to the various processing centers of New Cafe. And therefore, when it arrives there, that's when New Cafe is supposed to make a part payment. It can be 50%, it can be 60%, depending on the availability of capital. This is where it is always so challenging, for us to make sure that we have the available, capital. So the farm ownership model calls for value addition. And value addition, it means you have to take a bit of time for you to be able to add value to the farmer's coffee. And this is where a part payment becomes important, such that farmers can wait when New Cafe is adding value to their coffee. So these investments are a key component of adding value to farmers' coffee. The 7-in-1 factories that we have at a one-stop center here in Namanve are very, very important in the transformation that we are looking for in Uganda's coffee industry.
I understand Uganda or even New Cafe, you are not the people who determine prices. There is a global coffee body which Uganda is currently having trouble with due to discrimination. So how then do you confirm to the farmers that they will have a say in how much we buy the coffee for?
Yeah, I think everyone is aware that coffee marketing was liberalized, and therefore it is the market forces that determine, you know, prices. So as producers, what we embarked on, and especially Uganda, is to produce the quality, maximum quality of coffee, high quality of coffee. And we are involved in the production of specialty coffee, which is of highest quality. And therefore, we are selling quality. So it is that quality that we use to determine, you know, the price of coffee. Nobody will tell you that there is this body that determines the price of coffee. Not even the International Coffee Organization. International Coffee Organization is simply a coordinator, an organization that gathers statistics to do with the coffee from all over the world, from all over its members. Okay, so that's what ICO, the International Coffee Organization, is doing. It does not regulate prices, not at all. It is the market forces that do that. So the sellers and buyers meet and determine, you know, the prices. Of course, we must be aware that there is a lot of speculation that goes on in the marketplace. And this is the evil that has been characterized with the coffee value chain for ages. And that we must work hard as producer organizations to ensure that even within our own countries, we create a domestic market, such that the market is near with us, and that we can, you know, play around with the prices, and that we know nobody will come to say that this is how we are going to increase the prices. We are very much aware that consumption and the demand of coffee is much higher than what is produced. But because of speculation, they tend to play around with the prices such that they can go down. But even with that, we have seen in the recent past, especially in this year 2022, how prices, you know, have come up. Prices are supposed to be up, okay? But prices of raw commodities will never always, you know, be stable. So eventually what we have to struggle for is to ensure that we manufacture what we produce into a finished product. But of course, we must know the global political economy of coffee.
So of what importance was the International Coffee Organization to Uganda's visibility, and how will this affect Uganda in that we are taking a 2 years break from that, from the organization?
Yeah, of course, the importance is that it is always important to be in a club. Okay? And you try to come up with issues whereby the club members can agree upon, okay? But the point we are making is that there are issues that producer countries of coffee have always come up with to ensure that, you know, members of International Coffee Organization can agree upon. Let me, you know, look at what is the membership of the International Coffee Organization. First of all, the International Coffee Organization is an intergovernmental organization. Okay? Its membership is of producing and importing countries, okay, and by governments. So it is member countries, meaning that at the round table of International Coffee Organization, you have importing countries, you have exporting countries or producer countries. So you are not alone. Okay, now at that table you are discussing the point Uganda is fronting and other producer countries, not alone as Uganda, is that there is a lot that needs to be done at that round table of ICO. To listen to coffee producing countries, they would wish to add more value to coffee and export it as a finished product. Okay? But in importing countries, what is happening? There are stringent conditions on a finished product in terms of food safety. These food safety requirements are that stringent that for one to penetrate a market is not easy. Okay? And who owns these stringent conditionalities? It is the importing countries. And you must be aware that these food safety requirements are very subjective. Okay? So where we are coming from, we are coming from a point of high tariffs on value-added products. But point came and say, okay, now it is free entry into the market. But the main issue now is to do with food safety requirements. And these are difficult, to meet. And they are costly even because you have to meet certain, standards. So these are all conditionalities that prevent coffee producing countries from adding value and export, a finished product into the developed world. So these are issues that are pertinent and that ICO agreements need to put into consideration. So the point is the International Coffee Agreement 2007 expired, and then they called for an extension. But you are extending within an agreement that is not catering for your needs that are transformative. Okay? So we should appreciate the fact that these needs have to be taken into account. And we should appreciate the fact that if you are a member of a certain body and it is not catering for your needs, why should you stay? And it has expired. And by the way, is it Uganda that has first declared itself? No. Even the mighty United States of America has been pulling out and coming back, pulling out and coming back.
I understand. And that for sure leads us to go back and focus in our own countries. For like the 2 years Uganda is out, we shall need to do more work here. So talk to me about the farm ownership model. How relevant is this in trying to help us sell more coffee and encourage our own people to consume?
Yeah, what we came to appreciate is that at the farmer level, at the industry level, subsector level, at the country level, largely speaking, we have to take ownership. And when we talk about the farmer ownership model, it means we have taken ourselves to the farmer level. For the farmer to take ownership by taking responsibility for own transformation. Look here, If the farmer has been selling coffee on trees and no life has changed, okay? And we know very well doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different result, that is insanity, okay? Therefore, we cannot continue. So the farmer ownership model is saying, please, coffee farmer, it is time to transform from doing what you have been doing before, such that you can do things differently. So now the farmer, instead of selling coffee on trees as red cherries, instead of selling coffee as dry cherries, instead of selling coffee as parchment, it is high time you farmer, you sold coffee as first and foremost graded coffee. That alone enhances your income. You enhance your income by 250%. That one alone. Basic, you know, kind of, you know, processing, what they call agro-processing. You are not yet into manufacturing, but agro-processing. Now, for some time, farmers to spend time there, you know, that makes a big jump. Now, after some time, the farm ownership model says, then move to another level. That is transformative. You are doing things differently. That is what the farm ownership model is all about. The farm ownership model is saying we need to have policies that offers our, you know, own transformation to ensure sustainability. The farm ownership model is speaking to different sustainable development goals. It speaks to poverty eradication. You can see the jump that comes a long way in terms of income to the farmers, but also to the country, to our communities. You can see when the farmers take responsibility to make investments in, you know, infrastructure required for processing coffee. Okay? That is another sustainable development goal. Investing in renewable energy. Our factory during daytime runs on solar. So we are speaking to sustainable development goals number 7 and sustainable development goal number 13. So we are mindful of climate change and what it brings, what it impacts, you know, on our, you know, environment. Okay? So we are mindful of how women are critical in sustaining the value chain and therefore enhancing gender equity in all that we do is of paramount importance, and all that is part of our farmer ownership model.
So okay. I've seen a lot of women involved in the whole value chain here.
Yeah.
Is that something purposeful you're doing at New Cafe to have women as staff?
Yes, it is deliberate that we have women involved in the entire coffee value chain. For young, you know, women in the coffee value chain, it is very, very important. And each woman that you see at the New Cafe factory is representing not less than 6 people at home. So there is a huge multiplier effect why women are part and parcel of what New Cafe is doing.
All right, you mentioned earlier that about 5% of Ugandans are consuming coffee currently, and they were less in the past.
Yeah.
So would you attribute this to the farmer ownership model? Talk about its effect on consumption by Ugandans.
Yeah, the why we see coffee consumption is increasing, there are a number of factors. One, we have invested, the country is investing in improving the necessary skills along the entire coffee value chain. And individual players really are doing this because there are different skill sets that are required at different nodes of the coffee value chain. Never before did we have the barista skills that are required towards the end of the value chain. When you are in a cafe and you want to produce a good cup of coffee, it is not every Tom and Dick that is in position to do so. You need a barista, you know, who understands the language of a consumer. Now, these kind of skills, you don't find them in our universities and colleges, not at all. And therefore, these are of recent past. So Ugandans would not be interested in taking coffee because a cup of coffee that would be prepared in the last 20, 30 years would not be a best cup of coffee. Two, the purchasing power that is, you know, enhancing from time to time. You know, the middle class is emerging and therefore people have disposable income to grab a cup of coffee in a cafe. You know, 20 years ago we only had one coffee shop in Kampala as a city. Today we have more than 200 of them. So this tells you how, you know, the transformation is taking place. And of course, you know, the training places that are coming into place, you know, at New Cafe, you've seen, you know, our quality laboratory and where we train. We host on average, you know, 70 interns from the various colleges and universities, and people coming from also, you know, other places, non-school going, young people, you know, come around to learn. And also some academies are merging, you know, from all over the place. And these are some of the factors that are merging. And of course, we've seen also transformation in the policy. Our past policies focused more on coffee primary agricultural production. Today, when you look at the national coffee policy, which New Cafe advocated for a long time and engaged the government, it tackles the entire coffee value chain. When you look at the recent National Coffee Act 2021, it looks at the entire coffee value chain. So all these factors coming together, you know, are influencing also increasing domestic coffee consumption. And it is a good development. It is a good development looking at where we are coming from.
Now, if you are a regular viewer of The Business Show, you know that we've been running a month-long series of the money-making ideology with Frank Kapshenga. As we close the month, let's look at how you can make extra income.
Hello, viewers. I'm happy to be back. And now today, of course, starting with a recap from our previous discussion, we talked about how you protect your money. We looked at the contracts and the consequences of signing contracts without giving them the thought they deserve, and just signing out of excitement as a means that could put your whole idea of seeking to grow your money into trouble. Now, I also indicated that we'd be going to talk about an issue to do with ideas as means of growing money. Now that we have established how to love money, how to protect it, now we need to go deeper to see how do we go on the journey to search for this money. To start with, we all know what it means to have an idea. An idea is a course of action. As an individual, you sit down, you take off time to think of a course of action that you would take on that would generate money. Now I'm talking about money. Ideas can be about several things, but now here this is tailored to money. I'll sit here and say, how do I make money? But not just make it. Remember, we're talking about the money growth ideology. How do I grow my money, even what I have. I mentioned that I am an author. My first book to write was entitled The Smart Career Pursuit. How I got that money, that book, was through an idea that I picked to write and inspire professionals on matters to do with career and the youth, matters to do with career guidance and mentorship. And so I was able to print and publish this book in 2013. Now, when I would sell this book, I would make money. But that money was not enough. And like I indicated that, it is everyone's desire at any one point to have enough money to be able to buy at least your basic need or whatever you need, you'd want to be in a position to buy it. That means you'll need to have some money and probably some extra for saving to that bank account or for another rainy day. So I had printed this book, but I realized that how I thought to myself, how can I make better of this that I have? Now, I didn't need to go to the bank to look for more money to print more books or write another book. No, I just said, how can I make better of this book? Now, I moved and created a TV program based on this book, The Smart Career Pursuit. Now, that's just an idea. Now, ideas are our primary sources of capital. Usually when we talk about doing business, growing in business, the youth have no work, no jobs, not, but we have our ideas, which are real money, intangible money. Actually, I call ideas are our intangible money. So it is worth it and very important for you to always make time to generate these ideas and create what I call an ideas bank, such that you can always go and pick out one and execute it. And then you'll be able to grow your money. Then there is also a threat to ideas. And this is an issue to do with comparing yourself, your one day idea, to an idea that has been executed. So you feel like you are amidst giants and you can't breathe, and so you think your idea can't work. But I want to tell you that your idea can work, and always make time to think and establish ideas with a view of creating resources, and you will succeed. I never knew at some point that I could transform this book into and deliver it, provide it to audiences, in a different way. But it just took an idea. So what idea do you have? How do you sharpen your ideas? Now, we have ideas which are inborn within us. Now, on top of these ideas, I'd want us also to add on what I call sniffing opportunities. While ideas are inborn within us, majorly, now we can be able to also position ourselves to identify opportunities externally from within your environment. How do you identify opportunities? Some of us do not love reading, but reading is one of the best ways you can establish yourselves to identify and sniff opportunities. The newspapers, this New Vision, and many others has got so many opportunities. So many opportunities. Just reading a headline of a newspaper can give you an opportunity to be able to grow your money. But are we reading anyway? What are we reading about? Make time and gainfully utilize all literature that you can find that is constructive. Be it a book, be it a new vision, name it. Those are the sources of ideas that will eventually bring opportunities that will enable you to grow your money. Now, when you have embraced all this and created a routine on how you perceive and how you nurture them, then you will have established your own personal money growth ideology. Grow it. It's not a one day's thing. Grow it, and you will not be disappointed. At least I have told you one of my examples. It never disappoints. Now, opportunities, usually the most interesting and most important opportunities usually come in very disguised ways. You'll meet someone who doesn't seem to be your equal or your anyone in your spheres, and you want to shrug them off and move away. But if you had a deeper connection and talk with that person might be your next source of opportunity to advance and grow your money. So be keen to take in everybody and anybody that God brings your way, and give them enough time to study them and see what they could be carrying for you. Do not elevate yourselves too high to think that some people are so far below you, because it is out of those people that I have personally established and drawn the most interesting opportunities of my life to date. So you might be on the search of meeting the richest man in Kampala or the best business, but it is very, very, very important and so fulfilling when you establish your own unique money growth ideology and begin to see growth and improvement out of that ideology. It is very possible, and I would urge you to go for it.
Now, pockets of corporate dollar demand kept the Uganda shilling on the back foot at the start of the week, closing weaker on Tuesday. Let's now see how the shilling performed throughout the week. We've come to the end of this week's show. Thank you very much for making time. And as a business person, always remember it's very important to have healthy competition, but always look out for what could be comparative advantage over the next supplier in order to record returns. I'll see you next time. Good night.